Hi, this is Pat Love from Love Healing Hearts, here to play this morning's message. I preached at the All Nations Seventh-day Adventist, and I hope that it blesses your heart. I have tried in every way I can to upload it, and it will not, no matter which route I take, not even directly onto the website. So this is the best you're going to get. You got the song that barely squeaked through. I guess for some reason, the file is too large and it won't take it. So here we go. Listen with your heart, because you're not going to be able to look at anything but me sitting here. God bless you.
Father, we ask you to bless and anoint this word. Align my heart with your heart, my mind with the mind of Christ. Thank you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Luke chapter 24, starting in verse 1. I'm a word person, so that we will read. Now, upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid, bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but risen. Spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered unto the hands of sinful men, and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words, and returned from the sepulchre, and told all those things unto the 11, to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, and Joanna, and Mary the mother of James, and other women that were with him, which told those things unto the apostles. And their words seemed to them as idle tales. They believed them not. Then rose Peter and ran into the sepulchre, and stooping down, and behold, he beheld the linen clothes laid by themselves, and departed, wondering in himself at that which had come to pass. And behold, two of them went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 70 furlongs. And they talked together about all these things which had happened. And it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were holden, that they should not know him. And he said unto them, What manner of communication are these that ye have one with another and walk and are sad? And the one man, the one of them whose name was Cleopas, answering said unto him, Art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem and hast not known the things which are come to pass in these days? And he said unto them, What things? And they said unto him, Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and have crucified him. But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel. And beside all this, today is the third day since these things were done.
They didn't know it was Jesus.
Yeah. And certain women also of our company made us astonished, which were early at the sepulchre. And when they found not the body, they came, saying that they had also seen a vision of angels, which said that he was alive. And a certain of them which were with us went to the sepulchre and found him, even as so as the women had said. But him they saw not. Then he said unto them, O fools, and slow of heart to believe, ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. And they drew nigh unto the village whither they went. And he made as though he would have gone further, but they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. And it came to pass as, now let me say this real quick while I'm reading. Do you know how much more we could experience if we ask God to abide with us? How much more we could experience that personal connection, that personal relationship with God, if our souls hungered for him, if we yearned for his company, for his presence. How much more we would experience him in our daily lives if he was the one we wanted to be with when our hearts were broken, if he was the one we wanted to be with when we were excited about something, if he was the one whose advice we wanted, whose guidance we wanted, instead of getting on the phone calling our friends. Imagine how much more we would experience him if we yearned for him to abide with us.
Something to think about.
And it came to pass, as he sat at me, he took bread and blessed it and brake and gave to them. This is verse 30. And their eyes were open, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight.
Yeah.
Imagine what we could experience. Now, there are times our eyes are shut. There are times, even though we're walking with the Lord, there are revelations that don't get us right away. But thank God for his resurrection power. He has the ability to open our eyes to things we need to know to guide us through life. I mean, this whole resurrection, all the power that goes with it, has so much to do with us personally.
Yes.
It's not just a story. It's not just a historical event. It is something so powerful that we need to incorporate it in our lives. Okay. Now, what I want to say to you, I'm going to read a little bit of John, because this has to do with eyesight as well. And this says a lot of what I'm talking about. And then we're going to move over to Luke chapter 4, but we're going to break it up. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and listen to this, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Do you get that? The light comprehended it not. What we don't understand sometimes is because he is that light, he wants to shed light in your darkness, in your darkness, in your darkness. And you know, there are times when light brings darkness into our lives.
Hello.
And we don't know what to do with it because we can't see what's really going on. We don't get it. And that's normal because a crisis feels like darkness to us, doesn't it? So when you're going through life and life throws the blinders on you and you're trying to feel your way around and you don't know what's going on, our natural nature is to tense up. I'm going to imitate my late husband. And the reason I'm doing this is because I have to come down to do it. The reason I'm doing this is because he lost his eyesight a year before we started dating. He had a swagger. When he walked with, listen to this, I'm making a point. He walked with confidence. I mean, he entered the whole room, knew Brother Milton was in the room, the whole church knew Brother Milton was in the church. But listen to this, when he went blind, and he had to go to Braille Institute to learn how to use a cane to maneuver, and he had to learn mobility training, all kind of survival abilities, cooking, he was a great cook. But listen, when he moved, the swagger was gone. Some of you have gone through so much crisis, your swagger is gone. Your confidence is gone. But Jesus is alive. He's not dead. He's not dead. So listen, when you're walking, I'm going to imitate my husband now. When you're walking with a blind, with a cane, you're very stiff. Your body is very stiff because you want to make sure you don't trip over anything on the ground. You want to make sure you don't bump into anything. Your whole body is just, the whole thing just becomes stiff, and you're not really sure. You know, you're nervous, you're uptight. A lot of energy goes into just trying to maneuver and find your way. It's really difficult. But let me tell you this. If you be still and know that God is God, you won't have to be so uptight. Do you hear what I'm saying? Jesus is the resurrection and the life. And he sheds light on our darkness. He's not playing religion. He really wants us to know what it means to have his guiding light in our lives. Have you ever been in a room? I'm going to make a quick example. Have you ever been in a room where you turned out the light? We did this in an Overcomers meeting as an illustration. We turned out all the lights, and all of a sudden the whole room was almost pitch black. And we couldn't see a thing. We were sitting in a circle. It wasn't that big of a circle.
It's black.
Maybe as far as you are from me. That's about how wide the circle was. And do you know, when we asked, what can you see? Nobody could see a thing.
See a thing.
Can you see anybody?
No.
Nobody could see a thing. And I said, now what would happen if you jumped up, panicked, and started running around trying to get things, trying to get your tools and your keys, what would happen? And they all agreed, you'd be falling, you'd be bumping, you'd be hurting yourself, or
somebody else,
making a bad matter worse.
Right.
So what do you have to do? You have to sit. You have to get your bearings. You have to commune with God before you act. Do you hear what I'm saying? You have to get into God's heart before you decide, I have to do something about this. Because the first thing you have to do is acknowledge God in all your ways so he can direct your path. Because when he directs your path, you will not be hurt.
That's right.
You will not make a bad matter worse. Do you hear what I'm saying? So as we sat there in the group, do you know after about 2 or 3 minutes, people could not only see each other, but they could see what they had in their laps. They could see what they were wearing. All of a sudden, the dark got lighter and lighter because our eyes became acclimated to the dark.
Yeah.
And when a crisis comes into your life, you have to be still and know that he is God. You have to wait on the Lord and be of good courage, and he will strengthen your heart during that time.
Amen.
Yeah, life brings around, you know, life happens. Life brings a lot of stuff in our lives. But we don't understand that that is why Jesus is in our lives. It's not only to forgive us for sin. We're not only to escape hell. But there are hellish periods in our lives that he also delivers us from. There are emotional entanglements, hurts, pains that Jesus delivers us from.
That's right.
But when you're hurt, who do you go to? Do you get on the phone, girl, did you hear what they did to me? Or do you go to God? What's the first thing you run to? Do you realize that God will wipe away your tears?
Every time.
Do you realize that? That right in the midst of a bad situation, God will speak, peace be still to your soul,
right,
while the storm is still brewing.
Right.
I'm going to share a little private, a little bit of my business real quick. When I was in my 30s, I was married to my first husband. My first husband was addicted to pornography. And I'm going to share with you what the resurrection of my life did for me. We were married 2 months when I was 30. The second month, God gave me a dream that my ex-husband, he's also passed away, but that he was in the bed with another woman. Well, I'm not the jealous type. I'm not the suspicious type. I just figured, okay, another bean dream. But I didn't throw it out. I just laid it down. 3 days later, he came home soaked with tears. Very sweet person, he really was. He was soaked with tears, and he confessed to me that he had been with a prostitute. We had only, think about this, ladies, we had only been married 2 months. What a slap! Imagine what that felt like. After he confessed it, you know the first thing I did? I got up. I walked out of the room. Well, Patty, where you going? I said, I can't deal with this. God's got to deal with me first. So I went in the room, closed the door, locked it, and bore my soul out to God. Bore it out. Poured it out. Cried it out. All of my hearts, the feelings of betrayal, the shock, everything. I poured it out to God. And when I got through, I was in there over an hour. When I got through, I had peace. I had asked God to help me forgive. The forgiveness was there. I am telling you, when you go to God through those crises, He didn't raise from the dead just to stop us from going to hell, you guys.
That's right.
He's an integral part of our lives.
Everything.
Do you hear me? An integral part of our lives. We don't have to grow through the darkness. We don't have to.
And that is a portion where it cut off. And now we're going to go into the next video. So stay tuned. For station identification. Be right back.